I plan to talk about adaptive dynamics sampling, which is a new feature of 12C. But before that, just a short introduction about myself, so that you know who is speaking. If you need my Twitter handle, is this one. My name is Christian Tonini. I work for a company in Switzerland called TruBodies. I'm mainly involved with performance, let's say, problems. I usually try or hope to work more in avoiding problems in the first place. That means designing the system correctly. But most of the time, I must admit, I work for troubleshooting performance problems. But anyway, it's what I do usually on a daily basis. In 2008, I published this book for APRES. And last year, I, let's say, upgraded it to the newest version. By the way, in the bookstore, there are still some copies if you want one. There is also a discount of 20% for open world. And I am a table member and an Oracle Ace director. So that was about myself, about the session. What I planned to do it today is to start introducing, of course, what adaptive dynamic sampling is. Then we look at something very important, when it is used. Then we'll talk about some concept that goes with this feature. The first one is time limit, what time limit is and how it is used by the optimizer. Then we continue to see some strategies used by the key optimizer during the sampling phase. We'll also see how caching is used in this area, and finally see some, let's say, small problems that we discovered while testing the feature. And of course, I will end by just summarizing what I discussed. So, introduction. What is, in general, dynamic statistics, which is a new, let's say, name that was provided by Oracle in 12C. If you look at this picture, which is taken from the documentation, you see that there is adaptive query optimization. And adaptive query optimization is, let's say, part in two set of features. You have, from one side, the adaptive plans, from the other side, the adaptive statistics. In general, I will say that what it's under adaptive plans are feature that should, let's say, make something adaptive while a SQL statement is in execution. Okay, so an adaptive plan, while it is executed, it can change. And that happens in the two situations mentioned here, and I don't know why in the documentation they do not provide you the information that also with the star transformation there is a part which is adaptive. From the other side, adaptive statistics part, first of all, as the name mentioned, is about statistics, but I will say in general, something like dynamic statistics, which is basically the topic of this talk, or automatic reoptimization, a SQL plan baseline, are only, let's say, useful when you are parsing a statement. That is for the generation of a new execution plan. It is usually, if you want to take advantage of it, you need a new execution that use up. As a new parse. And if you are using a cursor which is upgrading the library cache, you are not taking advantage of any of this feature. From the other side, if you are in the adaptive plans part, I mean, during the execution, something can change. Okay, so that's how Oracle more or less positioned the feature. Now, dynamic statistic, what it is, is basically what we have since 9.2 with dynamic sampling. Okay, it's just a new name, dynamic statistics, and really simple put, what it does, it's simply that the optimizer, in some situation, if it doesn't find enough information in the data dictionary to generate a good execution plan, what it can do is just execute some sampling queries that access the data and tries to get all the insights from the data itself. Okay. So it's generating additional statistics during the parse phase, and the goal is to generate a better execution plan. For better, I mean, of course, which is faster. Okay, that's the idea of dynamic statistics, or how they call it now, adaptive statistics. Now, there are, as I already mentioned, several names which are more or less for the same feature. I usually prefer to talk about dynamic sampling and the specific topic about adaptive dynamic sampling, because it's a feature that was implemented. Then let's say the official name, it's in my opinion not very important. But anyway, the point is, in this session I cover adaptive dynamic sampling. From time to time I will refer to the old implementation of the dynamic sampling, what I refer to old style dynamic sampling. It's not an official name, it's, but it's how I call it. The point is really, I would say in general, let's say the first tip here is, if you are in 12, 1 or 2, I would say the feature might be good. In lower version, be very careful, maybe at the statement or session level it's okay, but I would be very careful at activating it at the system level. In any case, it's something that you have really to test carefully. For example, the person I mentioned before, we will soon production with that. It's an application that already in 11 requires the optimizer dynamic sampling set to 7 or 8. I don't remember exactly which one of the two. But the point is, without sampling, the thing doesn't work. Okay. So when 12 arrived, we started doing a lot of tests with adaptive dynamic sampling, because since the application relies on it, we thought it was a good idea to use the new technology. So the first way to activate it is explicitly set optimizer dynamic sampling to 11. Okay. But what is important to see that there are other ways to activate it. We will see in a moment. Another thing to know, in my opinion, is that even though you set optimizer feature enable all the release, for example, in this case, I set 10.205, it doesn't mean that the adaptive dynamic sampling is disabled. It's strange, because I, from one side, I ask Oracle to use the old optimizer, but at the same time, as you can see here, this outline data, I use the adaptive dynamic sampling layer. So the point here is that the feature is not deactivated where, if you set an old version of the optimizer, okay? So it doesn't overrule the setting. Now, let's have a look when the adaptive dynamic sampling is automatically used by Oracle. The first case is when you are using parallel processing. It's something that already happened in 11.2, that when the optimizer has, tries to generate a plan containing a parallel operation, what it can do is simply to automatically activate the sampling or increase the level of the sampling. If you have set the sampling to the default value, which is 2, the idea is that already in 11.2 is that the optimizer might decide, okay, it is weird that it's supposed to process a lot of data, so let's increase the optimizer dynamic sampling to 5, 6, whatever, to get more insight about the data and maybe generate a better plan. And the idea is really that since we are talking about a parallel query, it makes sense to spend, let's say, a few more seconds doing some sampling, but then generate a plan that maybe runs for minutes. So it's not a huge overhead. So that was already happening in 11.2. Now in 12.1, what is important to see is that depending how optimizer feature enable is set, you get automatically the new adaptive dynamic sampling, if it's set to 12.1.1 or newer, or 12.1.2. Or if it's set to a value, let's say, lower, we are using an older release, you can get the level you have configured, okay? The level, not the modes you have configured, that means the old dynamic sampling level. And this is, I would say, an important change, as you can see, depending on the release. Because in 12.1.01, the adaptive dynamic sampling was not automatically activated, okay? And since 12.1.02, if you leave everything set to the default and you are using parallel queries, the adaptive dynamic sampling can be automatically activated. Okay.
Chris, does this also depend on the values of some parallel parameters? And if someone set some parallel parameters in an earlier version and just left them in place,
I'm not aware of an impact of the parallel, let's say, parameters on that. Okay. What is also, in my opinion, a bit strange is that if you set optimizer feature enabled to 12.101, but you are in 0.2, okay, it's working a different way. So it's a bit strange how they implement it. But the point, again, is it's automatically used by Oracle when parallel processing is considered. The second situation where it's used is because of SQL plain directives. Now, I'm not explaining in detail what SQL plain directives are because it will take 1 hour alone. But simply put, I will say the optimizer in some situation now recognizes that during the part it should do something different, let's say, for example, doing dynamic sampling, and it can store this information in a SQL plain directive, which is stored in the data dictionary. So that during the next parse, the optimizer gets this information. And what the SQL plain directive does basically provides two kind of information. First of all, they can tell the optimizer to use dynamic sampling. Okay. And second, they can tell the optimizer, or better, the DBMS stats package, to generate automatically generate column groups. Okay. If you were here yesterday, Jonathan. Talked about it, I think, yeah. And which one is used really depends on the situation where you are. In fact, from one side, extended statistics or column groups have a maximum number per table, so if you already have 20, you cannot create a new one. And from the other side, for some expression, column groups does not help. I mean, if you have in an aware condition with an expression based on a function, taking a couple of parameters, you cannot, let's say, provide more information to the optimizer based on an extended stat. And therefore, in some situation, Oracle decides I stay with dynamic sampling, in other it tries to create extended statistics. But now, in the case that it uses dynamic sampling, it's important to know which one, the old one or the new one. And here, again, it depends which version you are using. If you are in 12.101, basically it uses the default level which is set at that moment. It can be at the system level, or if you change it at the session level one, or also at the statement level. Okay. But of course, if it's activating the sampling and you have set a level which is smaller than 4, it usually is not very sensible. And as a result, Oracle opens a bug, which is kind of enhancement request, not really a bug, something I don't know, they didn't think about. And therefore in 12.102, now it works in a different way, that is independently how you set your optimizer dynamic sampling at the system session statement level, when the sampling is activated through the SQL plain directive, it uses the level element, means adaptive dynamic sampling. And it is important to say that SQL plain directives can be created for basically every SQL statement, okay? And since for every SQL statement, the optimizer can use a directive, potentially for every SQL statement, you can see dynamic sampling appear, okay? So it's something that is no longer restricted to, like in 11.2, to the parallel processing part, but it's basically for every statement something that can happen. Therefore, in my opinion, it's really important to know that something like that happens and how maybe you can configure it. Because it's something new that will run anyway on 12.1. Okay. By the way, for this case, say, and the other one that we have seen before, okay, there are some undocumented parameters to reverse the functionality to 12.101. So if somebody has a problem with that, it's also possible to say, I want to use the default level which is set on my instance and not the adaptive dynamic sampling. Okay, so that's something which is possible. Okay, so these were the two situations in which the optimizer decides to automatically use it. Now, if we look when it is used more in general, if you remember how the old implementation implementation worked. Basically, in the old implementation, the dynamic sampling was only used if you had missing statistics or there were some expression or, let's say, complex predicates in the where clause, but not for, let's say, every possible statement. Okay, there were really a fixed number of cases where it was used. And now with the new adaptive dynamic sampling, there is no such restriction. Basically, again, every statement, the optimizer can decide, okay, it might be good to do some sampling. I don't know, maybe it was also a bug, but one time I also saw he was doing dynamic sampling with a select value from Dua. I mean, which doesn't probably return many more rows as one. But I saw this kind of situation. So the point is really that every statement you run, because of the SQL pen directive, because of what I'm explaining now, you can have some sampling going on. And also very important, the old implementation was used by the optimizer just to provide more information for single table estimation. That means when the optimizer was estimating how many rows are returned by scanning a table, then the dynamic sampling could be used to provide. What is good is not only used for a single table estimation, but it's also used for joins. So you can, let's say, provide or execute sampling query that returns information which is good or interesting for improving the estimation of the join. And also what is called query block cardinalities from stuff like group bys, for example. Okay, so when you have a query block that has some complex processing into it, the optimizer can, let's say, do some complex sampling as well. Notice that, as I mentioned here, the query block part, as we have, according to our test, is only there in 12.102. And the join cardinality part, we are not actually sure. The point is that we see sampling query in 12.1 only, it's not in 11.204. I'm sorry. We see the sampling query also in 11.204. But it seems that the result of this query is never used. So we were not able to see a case where the sampling query is executed and the output are used. But we see the sampling. So it seems that in 11.204, some pieces are still missing. Okay. So this was more or less when it should be used. And I hope that I made the point that basically every one of you is using 11.2. Two usually, I would say right now, might end up using adaptive dynamic sampling independently of the configuration which is in place. Now, the next major difference between the old implementation and the new implementation of dynamic sampling is that the old one, everything was based on a specific number of blocks, depending on the level you set. Okay, the optimizer computed a different estimate percent. It started from 32 blocks for the small levels, and it increased this number up to 4,000 or something like that at level 9. And level 10 was the full scan, no sampling. Now with the adaptive dynamic sampling, that subset that no longer exists, the idea is to base the sampling on time. That is, the optimizer decides before starting the dynamic sampling phase, how much time can use for it. Okay. This is called time limit. Okay. Time limit defines really how much time the optimizer can spend doing sampling queries. And what is important to see that in the old style dynamic sampling, you usually see only one query during a sampling phase. With the new one, there are many queries. Okay, how this time limit is computed? First of all, the time limit, the minimum is 1 second, and there's something else, and it might be, of course, also higher. And the idea is the following: when the optimizer gets a SQL statement, try to understand whether the SQL statement is known. I mean, it's checked, for example, the library cache, do a cursor for this statement already exist, for example. If he finds something, he gets information about how long the statement took. Then he checks the AWR, and again there he does a lookup and he tries to find information about the statement. And the idea is really that if the the optimizer finds that in the past the statement was executed in, I don't know, 10 minutes, okay, then the optimizer thinks, okay, it might be good to spend some time doing a better, let's say, or finding a better plan. Okay. From the other side, if the statement took a couple of milliseconds, the optimizer said, okay, I do not need sampling, probably the default plan is the good one. So the idea is to find out, based on the past, how much time it can be used. And here there is the first, I would say, major problem that we had in real cases, is that if nothing is found in the cursor cache in KWR, the default is 10 seconds. If you think about 10 seconds, it means every parse of every statement your system can take up to 10 seconds is quite a lot of time. Okay. And therefore, depending what kind of statement you are executing, it might be a problem. So for example, by the customer where we are, again, we are going to collection soon with that, we decided to set an undocumented parameter to say that the default is 1 second. The way that if nothing is found, which is the usual case there, we have at most 1 second of parse going on in this thing. Okay.
Yes?
Yes, it's for all the dynamic sampling. I'm talking about time limits. We'll see how much every query can take in a moment. Now, if we find something, how this information is used, it depends. I would say here I have an example. If you have a statement, for example, which is still in the cursor cache, and it has less than 10 executions, then basically what the optimizer does is that it takes the CPU utilization, not elapsed time, CPU utilization, and then divide it by 10. So if you find a CPU utilization of 1 minute divided by 10, say, okay, it can take up to 6 seconds to parse it. But of course, if the number of utilization is higher, it will be a different computation. But the point is they base that on the CPU utilization. What we also noticed during our test is that in 11.204 and 12.101, only the default value was used. Okay. Some situation also there you see queries, but we never saw a case where the result of the query was used to compute the time limit. It seems that, again, it was partially implemented, the function. And the last bit of information about the time limit, if you're using, for example, a standard edition or an enterprise without diagnostic pack, usually what you would not expect are queries against the AWR repository. Okay? And here there is a bit of a problem because the control management pack access parameter is only evaluated from 12.102. So in 12.101, dependently how you set it, if you have set it to none because you have no license, you have the queries against the AWR views that are executed, which is of course basically not good. But since it's Oracle doing it, I would say that should not be a licensing problem for you. Okay, this is the time limit, so the time that the whole dynamic sampling phase can take. Now, as I said before, every dynamic sampling phase can execute several statements. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot that there is light in tweets. So what is this slide about? I wanted to show you which are the queries executed to find information from the cursor cache. This one is from 12.102. 12.101 is a bit different. So if you look for this SQL ID on your system, you should be able to find out whether it's frequently executed or not, because it never changes depending on the system. What is interesting to point out in this query is that, first of all, it accesses GV$SQL. So if you have a rack system, it takes in account all instances. That was not the case in 12.101, for example. It does the lookup based on the SQL ID, makes sense, okay, since you are looking at a specific query. It checks if the number of execution is larger than zero. And then there is also a restriction on the parse schema, that in my opinion, is interesting in case you have in the same database, you have a database with several users that use the same application. If you have a user which is shared by everybody, it's not a problem. But if you have users connecting the database with their own user, of course, for this user, the query is probably not very useful, because even though somebody else already executed the same thing, it will not find anything. But again, if you have a technical user, it should not be an issue. And on the next slide, doesn't use the container only. The query changes, I don't think so, but it's something that, yeah, it's interesting, it could be a thing that I should check. And on the next slide, I put the query which is used for AWR. It, I would say similar, of course, it goes on AWR views. Here the additional checks which is added, which is interesting to point out, is this one. So the end interval time of the snapshot must be in the last 7 days. So if you have, for example, query executed only at the end of the month or something like that, basically this information is not visible to the optimizer, which again can be a problem in some situation or no problem at all in all. So these were the two queries, just to let you know, if you search for these SQL IDs in your system, you can see how much or how frequently they are executed. Okay, now back to the point I was making before. Time limit is the execution of the whole parse phase for the dynamic sampling. But since several queries can be executed, the optimizer computes also the so-called time slice. And it's the amount of time that every single sampling query can take. How they compute it is shown on this formula. It basically takes the time limit, and multiply by 1,000 to get milliseconds, divide by the your candidate tables, something like that, I guess. It's basically the number of tables you have in the from clause, and divide by 4. Okay. So for example, if the time limit is 250 milliseconds, making more than the time slice, the query should be killed, okay, by the engine. When you trace and with SQL trace such an operation, you can see this kind of error in the trace file. There is a new error that was added for that. From the other side, is if the time's limit is completely used, the list optimizer no longer starts new sampling queries. Okay, so basically you have the kills only for the time slice. And it can execute so many queries as the time limit is expired. Okay. So these are the two concepts: time limit, time slice is the amount of time that can be spent by the optimizer. And in my opinion, it's also a good, let's say, concept or idea, or much better than just using a fixed number of blocks like with the Vault implementation. Because if you think about sampling a large table with, based on, I don't know, 128 blocks is more or less nothing. It doesn't provide really useful information in many situations. Okay. Let's see how the sampling queries are executed. Strategies. First of all, as I said before, all style dynamic sampling is usually, as far as I know, it's always one query. With the new adaptive dynamic sampling, is many queries. The number will depend on the SQL statement. Basically, if you have many tables, you will see many sampling queries. If you have many indexes, you will see many queries. If you have complex statements as well. And the point is that even for a, let's say, not that complex SQL statement, you can easily see 10 to 30 sampling queries that are executed. And they can be even much many more. So it's not just one, two, or three, but usually it's 10 or more, even in the simplest case. Okay. The number depends, as I said, on the statement itself, on the structure that you have in the database, but also on the release. we have seen the newer release execute more queries. Okay. So in general, 12.1.0.2 is the one that executes more sampling queries. This query in general do block sampling, but not always. And based on our test, what we found is that for tables which have less than 800 blocks, they do basically a full scan of the table. And for tables which are larger than 800 or larger, basically they do a sampling. Okay, and that's a really, in my opinion, interesting point, because as I said before, the number of blocks which were considered for a sampling in the old implementation was quite small. I mean, started from 32. Okay, now the minimum is 800, so it's probably much more. And in addition, if the segment gets larger, this number is also increased. That means if you have a table that has 1,000 blocks, basically what the optimizer does, it computes what is the percentage, let's say 800 divided by 1,000, so it's 80%. So we do a sampling based on 80%. On the other side, if the table is larger than 8,000 blocks, then what we see is that they compute the sampling based on 8,000. And if the table is larger than 80,000 blocks, it computes the sampling percentage of 80,000. So depending how large is your table, the sampling percentage change. But the point is that you are accessing many more blocks. And if you think about accessing 80,000 blocks, it can take, let's say, some time. It's not a couple of milliseconds in most situations. And then how they use this, as usual, they put the sample clause in the from clause of the sampling query. They specify the sampling percentage here. They always use 8 as the number of blocks that are, let's say, accessed in one I/O. And then they also add a seed, which always start from 0 or 1, don't remember. But the point of this seed is that if a sampling query is executed and the sampling query doesn't return something interesting, usually it means it returns 0 rows, then basically the optimizer restarts the same query but with a higher sampling percentage. And for higher, I mean, usually you see a factor of 2 which is involved. So for example, if they start with 1%, you say, okay, now it doesn't work, let's try with 2%. 2% is not good. It's start again with 4%, okay? And by every restart, basically the seed here changes. Got 1, 2, 3, 4. The idea is to, let's say, access different data on the table on every sampling query. Okay. So this is the block sampling which is used in with adaptive dynamic sampling. It is much more data is accessed than with the old one.
How does it know that it's reliable data or not?
Honestly, I don't know whether they have very complex checks to know whether the data is good or not. For sure, what I notice is that quite often, if you have sampling query that returns no data, the optimizer knows it's not interesting, so they restart it. But I can imagine that they have some better logic into it. But honestly, I have really no idea what they do. We didn't really investigate this situation because it's quite
another
difficult.
Question, the sampling of the block, is it random block from different extents, or from an extent it can be just block?
Okay, how the sampling works is based on the sample block clause. It means you should, the engine tries to distribute, let's say, the sampling on random blocks. But it's not something, let's say, special for adaptive dynamic sampling. It's the common syntax that exists since 8 or something like that, and it's used by adaptive dynamic sampling. Okay. So this is the block sampling which is performed. Now let's have a look to the kind of queries that you can expect to be executed. First of all, if the optimizer tries to improve a single table cardinality, what it does, it executes one or several queries that contains basically the where clause, which is with column of the table it is accessing. So if you have a where clause with a couple of conditions, what you might see in this case is a sampling query that simply does a cell count from table where different conditions which are were close. Okay. In this case, for this query, the sampling clause is optional. It means, as I explained in the slides before, depending on the size of the segment, it uses or it accesses more or less data. Okay. And several queries can be executed, as I explained before. In general, the optimizer gives the chance to use a full table scan or an index rate scan. In fact, they add this int in the query. Remember that even though it's a recursive query, the optimizer has to generate it, and then they have to parse it later on. So it's interesting that they add some ints to instruct itself to something. But in general, they say, okay, full scan is good, index range scan is good, but an index fast full scan is not good. So they make sure it is int that is not used. Okay. And in general, this query is, let's say, quite simple. It just takes everything from the where clause, and it also makes sure that if there is an index for it, it's possible to do an index-only scan. This is for the single table cardinalities. For index cardinalities, this one is used basically for every index which is which has a column reference in the where clause. And so you have a where clause with 3-4 predicates, those on 3-4 columns. Basically, every index containing this column is scanned with a sampling query. And as you can imagine, if you have many indexes, can immediately increase the number. And actually, what we also noticed that for every index, for some reason, they always execute at least two queries. It's not always the case, but in general, we see two or more queries for each index. In this case, the optimizer makes sure that it's an index-only scan. So the int which is used is index. Because, of course, if it's, let's say, the goal is to sample how many rows an index returns, it doesn't make sense to access the table. For the index queries, we didn't see frequently a sampling. And it's also interesting to notice that the block sampling syntax we have seen before with the indexes is not really useful. So they do the sampling in a completely different way. We also noted in some situations they try to reduce the number of rows by adding some where clause that just look at part of the data. That's possible. Okay. But in any case, again, if for every index that it's relevant for the query, you might see several sampling queries. Then if you have joins, the idea is that for some of the join, not all, okay, the optimizer executes sampling queries that contains at most two tables. And so if you have M in depth, you have a foreign key, and you might imagine they generate a sampling query with the two table and the where condition to join the two tables. But it's not for every permutation, so it's only a specific case where I guess the optimizer thinks it's a good thing to generate such a sampling query. Okay. If the sampling clause is used, what's interesting to note is that the sampling clause is added to a single table. That I would say makes sense, because if you have two tables, you sample one table, and independently you sample another table, and you try to join the two sets of data, there are probably not many chances to get some row from it. So what the optimizer does, it samples one table, and the other one is not sampled. So the idea would be, I guess, if the table is small, the join can be done with an edge join. Otherwise, only a nested loop can do, a good job. Okay. And as I mentioned before, these queries, we see them in 11.204, but we never see that the optimizer use the result of the queries. We think that the feature is only, completely implemented in, starting from 12.1. And finally, what is still available, it's also available are the query block cardinality adjustments since 12.1.2. And in this case, the idea is that for stuff like, for example, a group by, the whole query block that contains the group by can be used to base a sampling query. So in this case, you see sampling query with more than two tables. It really depends how many tables the query block contains. And the idea, of course, is to try to get information about, for example, an aggregation that could be also something different. Okay. So the point is that what we have seen before were always, let's say, simple queries. When you have the query block cardinality adjustment, it can be also quite complex. And in general, the query contains everything which is necessary. That means all the join condition, the where condition, which are in the query block, and whatever the query requires. Okay. And it means, at the end, if you look at this, think about these few slides, as I said at the beginning, there are really a lot of queries that can be executed. They really are small query with five, six tables, and you immediately have maybe 10 indexes that might be involved, and so on. You quickly end up seeing tens of dynamic sampling query. And since there are many queries, and since this query are as, I would say, as generic as possible, the optimizer try to execute them, let's say, in the best possible way, or the fastest possible way. So what Oracle implemented is some caching. And here there are two kinds of caching which I use. There is an internal cache for which I always, let's say, heard that it exists, but I never was able to, let's say, see it because there is no trace to get information about it. But the point is, internal cache is used when in a single parse operation, several times, the optimizer will like to try to execute several times the same sampling queries. That can happen if you have a query transformation. And so the idea is, okay, just execute in one parse only one time a specific query. From the other side, what it's easy to see to be used is the reserve cache. This every dynamic sampling query contains also, let's say, the reserve cache int, so that the result of the query can be stored in the reserve cache. Okay, this one, of course, is used when you execute several parses operation. Okay. So one is for one parse, and the other one is for several parses, can be reused. As I mentioned, what they do, they simply add the reserve cache int. Notice that it also changed the syntax for that, because since 12.102, now you see this kind of int reserve cache snapshot equal 3600. The meaning is quite simple. In 11.204, in 12.101, the invalidation of the cache happens as it usually happens with the reserve cache. It means if something is modified on the table, the cache is invalidated. Of course, in this case, since we are doing sampling, it's not only very sensible. Therefore, in 12.102, they added this option that tells the engine to invalidate the content of the cache, or the entries of the reserve cache, after 1 hour. Okay. That is, there is a special invalidation for the adaptive dynamic sampling, which is implemented right now. Okay. But the point is really that with this feature, the optimizer tries to spend as less time as possible to execute the query. Also very important, the optimizer tries to use it, but if you set result cache map size to zero, okay, then the optimizer cannot take advantage of it. So be very careful. If you want to use adaptive dynamic sampling, you usually need some reserve cache. Okay. By default, it's available. I know more than one DBA that says, our application doesn't use it, so let's save these few hundreds of megabytes that are put in the cache. Okay, so be careful. And of course, reserve cache is only an enterprise edition feature, so if you are in a standard edition, in case it's not possible, take advantage of it. So caching is really an important, important subject when you are dealing with adaptive dynamics. So keep an eye on the reserve cache, whether there is some free space. In general, it doesn't use much memory. You because if you think about a sampling query, it just does some counts, and it's not returning megabytes of data. So every entry for a sampling query takes really not much space. So if you leave only 100 megabytes, you can already store a lot of entries. Okay, and to finish, some problems we noticed. The first one is that we are simply in some situation the engine is not able to enforce the time limit or time slice. That means that even though, for example, with a time limit of 10 seconds, it's possible to see dynamic sampling query that goes in minutes. Okay, and it seems that in some situation the engine is really not able to kill the executions. No idea why, but we notice that also 12.102 is a bit better. But at the end, it's quite easy to reproduce a case. You take a very large table that you know that and a query that you know that use that sampling, and it's quite easy to have sampling or parsing that takes minutes. It's really easy. Not really. You have only the maximum you can set, and the maximum, as far as I remember, in 12.102 is 46 seconds, something like that. Any case, but I tried it really with large segments. I mean, really terabytes to see if it's really running, and you know, it's really running for minutes. You don't care about anything; you just want to run. What is not good that we notice is that sometimes, even though you have all necessary object statistics in place and the estimation of the optimizer are perfect, you notice that the optimizer decides, oh, I would like to do some sampling, and then based on sampling it does, let's say, estimation which are not good, that at the end you get a worse execution plan. That's for sure a bit a corner case, but such situation exists. So do not think that because there is a sampling, the estimation are in all situation better. There is a problem if you're using the partition extended names, front rows, table name, and then you specify the partition names. The problem is that basically the partition name is not used in the dynamic sampling queries. That means that the sampling is completely, broken. This one, there is also a patch. We have also installed it. Where I'm using this feature right now, because we are using the semantic graph option, and this option relies on partition names everywhere. So if you install the patch, it's a one-off. It's not a problem, and the problem is fixed. Yes. To enforce something, yeah, you might end up in this. In every situation where you have the partition which is specified in the front rows, the point is the dynamic sampling query do not contain the partition name, as of course you are sampling completely wrong data, and it's quite likely that you get wrong estimations. The last point, which is not yet considered a bug, I have an SR open since I don't know how many moons, but many. The point is the following: if you are in 12.102, you have the dynamic sampling set to a level which is smaller than 11, okay, and adaptive dynamic sampling is activated by a SQL plan directives. Basically, what you get from output on from DBMS6 plan, or basically from the middleware SQL plan view about the dynamic sampling level, is wrong. Usually what you see, yesterday in Jonathan's presentation, it was a case, you always see dynamic sampling used level 2. But if you think about the level 2 works, which is the default, for most queries, level 2 doesn't do nothing. Okay. So what happens is that level 2 is what is configured at the session level, but what the optimizer uses is the 11. But since the information they show you there is taken from the other XML, and the other XML contains the current session information, not what the optimizer used, you get an information which is wrong. And I'm still discussing with support whether one is better than the other. In my opinion, they should show what they are using, not how it is set at the section level. But it's let's see, this one is a small one. It's just not nice that you get the plan, you have the node section, and it contains wrong information. Okay, so in summary, I would say, my opinion, adaptive dynamic sampling is really an interesting feature. It contains a lot of improvement compared to the old implementation. In some situations, it also do a really excellent job. Fully advise it to use it. Customer, where dynamic sampling is important. From the other side, you really have to test it a lot to see if it does what it does. Okay? Because as I mentioned before, what we notice is that in general, the optimizer tries to use much time for case parsing. Therefore, we have to reduce the default time limit. Okay? Because in our situation, what we saw is that use it basically for analytical queries that takes between 3, 5, 10 seconds, usually, sometimes minutes. And now see if you add 10 seconds to the 3, 5 to 5 seconds, of course it's the query is much slower, which is not very useful. So we decide to reduce it to 1 second so that it doesn't impact that much the users, but it helps finding a better execution plan. So overall we have execution time which are lower, even though the parse time is much higher. So we reduced execution time from about 50%, I would say, compared to the old style dynamic sampling. But it's interesting that the parse time goes up by, I don't know, 300% probably, something like that. So test it. If it works, it might be a very interesting feature to consider. And be also careful. As I mentioned before, every release is a bit different. I would advise it at the system level only 12.1 or 2. But again, if it works for you, fine. But in general, I would say it's probably more a feature that it might be sensible to activate at a session or even at the statement level. Okay, that is basically what I prepared for today. Additional questions? So the question is how to monitor the effectiveness. What we did in the actual project is really that we have a...
I'm sorry?
You have something under the chair.
We have a benchmark framework where we can start a bunch of queries.
Thank you.